Let's say there is this beautiful kingdom in the world, and so lovely, and so prosperous, and so wonderful. And you are a traveler, come to this kingdom, and you're greeted, and the people say, come on in, come on in, come on in. You're very welcome here. And then they say, we know that you are a very wise person, and we just ask one thing of you to live in this kingdom. You see that there are some barbarians outside the kingdom, and they've been threatening us. We feel threatened by them. So we just want you to tell us how we can defend our kingdom better, because you certainly, you see how beautiful and wonderful this kingdom is, and there's such beautiful people here, and they're all so spiritual and lovely, etc. And it would be an incredible tragedy if the barbarians would come in and destroy them. So can you please show us how to defend this kingdom, what our weaknesses are, etc., etc.? That's pretty much the setup of the world as it is. So, what is going on there? Here is the fact. By trying to engage us in defending beauty, prosperity, the quote-unquote, the kingdom, a beautiful kingdom, what we're trying to do is figure out how God would defend reality. Okay. So to better study these defenses and find out a way to breach these defenses. And yet, in this delusion we're in, we don't realize that. We don't see it. Nothing real can be threatened, and nothing unreal exists. That is a fact. Nothing real can be threatened. So anything that is threatened, this is the deception, the trap of existence. If you're trying to evaluate and figure out how better to defend something that seems worth defending, what you're really doing is you're feeding this fire of delusion by giving more fuel to study. So let's say you erect all these defenses. We say we don't want the barbarians coming in this beautiful place, so let's defend it this way and this way and this way. Very clever defenses, you know. What happens is the barbarians can see, and they say, aha, these are the ways that God might be defending reality. And so we can go to work on these defenses, find ways to breach these defenses. It's just like these bodies are supposed to symbolize life, symbolize reality. And we have quote-unquote health. And then we have all these sicknesses attacking the body. And we're developing all sorts of ways to protect ourselves from these sicknesses. And yet then these sicknesses have more and more and more to work on. They say, okay, this is how reality is going to defend itself against our attack. So now we can study it and study it and study it and figure out ways to breach these defenses and attack reality. This is how existence works. This is the grand deception of existence. Jesus said, love your enemy, resist not evil, agree with your adversary. That is the way you defuse this whole scenario. You don't try. You do not play the game of defending, developing more and more sophisticated defenses. That is exactly what the game is. That is delusion. That is duality. The purpose of existence is to find a way to threaten and destroy reality. But we don't know how reality can be attacked. Why? Because it cannot be attacked. So we're inventing, we've imagined this scenario, and we're symbolizing reality by life, by civilization, by beauty, by things that seem valuable. And then we're attacking this value. And then we're having value continuously defend value. We're continuously defending value so that attack has more and more things to work on to figure out how can we get past this? How can we get past this? But the good news is that none of this has anything to do with reality. Reality has no defenses. Its defenses are that it's defenseless. It has no defenses because it doesn't need defenses. Real, he cannot be attacked. What is real cannot be threatened at all. So can duality be seen through? Absolutely, yes. Welcome to the video. It is October 7th. Can you believe that? October 7th. United States election is 30 days away. And after that point, leading up to it, and then after that point, after that, the deluge of activation, the whole scenario of this planet is going to be swarming. You know how a hive suddenly swarms? That's what's going to happen. And frenzied activity, frenzied. The world is going to become frenzied as all the defenses we've developed are going to be attacked now. Okay, because there's been an attempt to develop all the defenses. Duality has something of value, defends the value, and then those defenses are attacked. Okay, as we try to figure out how to attack reality. That's it. So there will be a frenzy of activity after the election. Everything will seem to be attacked. Okay, and we think, oh my gosh, all this stuff we've built up and defended is now being broached, you know, breached. And my God, you know, everybody just like, where are the heroes? Where are the heroes? Where are the heroes? And this is another aspect of the dream. The heroes come in and they're supposed to defeat something. And the defeat is supposedly is the defeat of something real. Okay, the destruction of the invaders. The invaders coming in, the heroes come in, they destroy the invaders. And that's an aspect of this dream, is that we're trying to develop the capacity to destroy something that is real. Okay, a causal agent. Some causal agent comes in from outside the dream. You destroy that agent. The heroes destroy that causal agent. That is still the destruction of something that is real, right? And what is real? Reality is real. So we're the heroes trying to find a way to destroy what is real, as are the invaders. Both. So existence is such a setup. Total setup. 100% setup. And Jesus said, don't have anything to do with it. Resist not evil. Agree with your adversary. Love your enemy. In other words, don't attack your enemy. Don't be a hero. Don't get sucked into being the hero role. Love your enemy. Agree with your adversary. Don't be a hero. And resist not evil. Don't try to defend what we've labeled as having value in this world. Okay? It's right there. Nothing real can be threatened. Reality has no defenses. Doesn't need any defenses. So it's super important leading up to the U.S. election. U.S. election is a tipping point. It is the tipping point. And coincidentally or not, right before December 21st, 2012, which is just kind of a marker date, which sort of dates the tipping point. The election starts the avalanche almost, you know. It's the boom that starts the avalanche, and suddenly you see a little bit of stuff loosening, and then suddenly, whoo, the avalanche starts coming. Remember that these supposed life forms, again, are that's not real life at all, these bodies. It's just a symbol of life. And the purpose is so that they can be attacked and destroyed, and that we can build all these defenses against that from happening, so that then these defenses can be worked on and gotten through, because we are not able to attack reality, you see, and we figure reality must have some super, super sophisticated defenses, so we're working on trying to figure out those defenses. It's just like the whole computer thing. You have all these hackers and then all these security experts that are trying to prevent the hacking from taking place. Same game. You have something of value, servers, corporate, you know, data, all this data, government corporate data, and that's they try to protect it, and then you have these hackers who are hacking in, trying to get at it, and it just goes back and forth, more and more sophisticated encryption defenses, etc., more and more sophisticated ways to get around it. That's the game. That's the game of duality, game of existence. How to destroy what is real. That's the idea that we had of wanting to be prime creator necessitated us to try and figure out how to destroy what is real, or at least have the destructive potential. We're trying to develop the potential, okay? We don't really want to destroy what is real, okay? But we want the potential to destroy it. We want the weapon in our hands. And then we can say, okay, God, if you have to change reality and make us prime creator, otherwise we're going to use this potential that we have. So we're trying to figure out. Now, it seems like we're defending what is life, etc. But that defense of life is just a setup for the destructive dynamic of existence to figure out a way to get past this very clever defense. That is a fact. So it sort of turns the whole thing on its head, right? Flips it upside down. Which is exactly what needs to be done. And we're so used to thinking, protect value, protect value, protect value. And now suddenly we see all this protection of value is just a setup for the destructivity to come in and breach these defenses, figure out a way to breach them. And then we harvest that information into potential, the potential to be able to threaten reality, threaten what is real with destruction. So all these destructive cycles we go through is just a harvesting of this information. That's all it is. This whole thing's just been a setup. Civilization, bodies, corporal life here, all of that is simply the setup to devise all these defenses, and then the destructive comes in, destructivity comes in, finds a way to get through these defenses and destroy everything, and then we harvest all that information, all that data. It's data harvesting. That's what's going on. We harvest the data, and then we sort of store it as stored potential. And we believe at some point we'll have this potentiality will somehow be catalyzed into something real, a real threat to reality. And then we can go to the bargaining table, get prime creator to the bargaining table. And we believe that this destructive cycle that's coming is going to be the one that puts us over the top. Of course, we always believe that, which is why we keep getting suckered along. Nothing real can be threatened, so how can we put ourselves over the top by harvesting all this data from this latest breaching of all the defenses? And you can, if you're aware at all, you can realize that the defenses are being breached. The defenses of civilization are being breached. Absolutely, they are. You know, these super secure websites are being hacked regularly. The whole infrastructure of this planet is going to be breached from various angles, many, many angles. That's the game. It's all a setup. It's all a setup. One hand pretends that it doesn't know what the other hand is doing. You know, constructivity and destructivity. Constructivity pretends that it doesn't know that it's just a patsy for destructivity. That's really in cahoots. On the surface, it seems like they're enemies, but underneath, they're total collaborators. When you see war, when you see conflict, you think, wow, there's two enemies, they hate each other, etc. But underneath, they're collaborators. Because they are simply engaging in this defend and attack, to harvest data about ultimately to get this potential to attack reality. So existence is a sham. It's all a sham. There's nothing of value here. Nothing of value. What is impermanent has no value. None. But it's all a way that it's a laboratory that we're working on this, harvesting the data, developing more and more sophisticated defenses. You know, trying to develop more and more value, so then we're driven to develop more and more defenses of that value. You know, if we don't value something, why would we like be defending it in existence? So the more value we can get, the more we feel that we have to defend this from being, you know, taken away from us. And then those defenses then become grist for the mill of destructivity. Destructivity is studying these defenses and saying, okay, so how do we get around these defenses? Just like hackers studying, you know, a data's protection, data protection, saying, okay, how do we hack into this, you know, this information? Just like that. So really it's necessary to see it this way and turn everything upside down, as it were. Going back to love your enemy, resist not evil, agree with your adversary. Nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists. Puts you in a different perspective. Very different perspective. Just a second, let me... And I don't know what the outcome of that is necessarily. Ultimately, it will be choosing a new idea, experiencing unconditional love. But as far as where you're going to live, what you're going to do, all these things, I'm not sure about that. I really am not sure about that, but we're going to find out. We're going to find out. I'll use myself as a guinea pig for you. Someone has to be a guinea pig in that regard. So here's this beautiful kingdom, beautiful place. The hero comes and they say, oh, welcome, hero. We're so worried about being attacked. And can you show us how to defend this beautiful, valuable place? And you say, okay, I'll defend it. And then that's exactly what the game is. And then those damsel in distress say, oh, I'm so beautiful. I have so many jewels. I don't want to be despoiled, you know, please protect me. How can you protect me? And the hero devises all these walls and ramparts and moats and weapons and everything. And then the barbarians are just sitting at the gates, just smiling, saying, yeah, it's exactly what we want. Great. Okay. You know, now we can go to work on devising the weapons and what means to breach these defenses. That's exactly what the damsel in distress wants is. That's exactly what the barbarians at the gate want. That's exactly what the game of existence wants. Okay? It's all a sucker's play. But you do, you go to a beautiful place, you know, no defenselessness, don't offer any defenses at all. And you think, oh my gosh, that's terrible. We're going to be destroyed. No. Because the barbarians at the gate will look and say, there's no defenses here. We can't learn anything here. We can't harvest any data here. This is a complete waste of time. They'll leave. They'll leave. They'll say, we want to go to some place that's heavily defended so we can figure out how to breach these defenses and we can harvest that data. But if you have no defenses at all, say, come on in. No defenses here. Make yourself at home. They'll, poof, gone, leave. They'll spit, poof. Yeah, this is ridiculous. Nothing here. Let's move on. That is a fact. That is how perfect safety lies in perfect defenselessness. In this dream of existence, reality needs no, doesn't even need perfect defenselessness. It doesn't have any. It can't be attacked. It can't be threatened at all. But in this dream, perfect defenselessness is peace and is safety, because there's nothing there. No data can be gathered. The purpose of existence sees nothing there. It won't even register. It doesn't even register. So you can see victim and victimizer, you know, they're collaborators. They're harvesting data. They're agreeing to a scenario of defenses and breaching of the defenses, and then harvesting that information, that data, to develop this potential to destroy reality. So then that prime creator can be forced to change reality and make us prime creators. But we don't have to play that collaborative game at all. We can just be perfectly defenseless, which is perfect protection in existence. if you have unconditional love, invite everyone. Everyone is equally free to come in. No defenses. Existence sees no purpose for you whatsoever. No data, zero data to be gathered, which is a complete anathema to existence. Existence will flee from you. You know, the attackers, you know, and the whole game will flee from you. So it's like, to them, it's like a black hole. Horrible. Nothing there for them. Nothing there for them. And, it's an abhorrence to them. No data to be gathered. Zero. So it doesn't further the purpose of existence. Therefore, it's a nothing. It's not there. So you can be... They tried to arrest Jesus many times and then to stone him and kill him and everything. They couldn't even see him. Just walk right through the crowd. Nobody lay a hand on him. They couldn't even recognize him because perfect defenselessness. There was no data to be harvested there. That's the Passover principle. So that is in play in existence. It's always in play. So don't be the hero. Instead, be the zero. Don't offer up defenses. At the deepest, this is true at the very deepest level. The very deepest level. And we need to begin to tune into this. It seems like a lofty goal. But it is there. It is absolutely there. This Passover principle is there. And that will be needed in the days to come, because as all these attacks are launched against civilization, against what we value, in order to harvest data, right? Then also the call for heroes to defend against the attack will arise. That's sort of the also storyline of how can we destroy these barbarians too? Okay, that's also part of it. So everybody's going to be pulled into this attack and defend and succumb and all this stuff. You see it throughout history. Look at history, all these wars and attacks that are, and you see how it works out. All that's happened in history is harvesting of data on vulnerability, how the potential to breach defenses and how to attack what seems to be valuable. The attack can come from microbes, it can come from viruses, okay? It can come from all sorts of illnesses and sicknesses, pestilence, it can come from famines, it can come from floods and tsunamis and earthquakes. It can come from, wars and bombs, all myriads of angles it comes from. It can come from being shocked and your lowered immune system. But if you have no desire to play this game at all, and you know that nothing real can be threatened, then there's no data that can be harvested from you. You're seen as a non-player in the game. So you're left alone. You're left alone. Nothing to be gained. Nothing to be gained. And the purpose of existence is to gain this information. So, and it doesn't waste its time. It's purposeful. It's very purposeful. It's not going to just do it for the heck of it. There's a saying that if you're being attacked, don't resist. Don't resist, don't defend, don't offer any resistance. And the attack will lose its impetus. Lose its impetus. That's just an example. It goes even further than that you can have no, not even be a player in this game, and it won't even attract any attack at all. Just peace. You'll be in, you'll be left in peace. And the dream claims that you're losing out. You're not contributing. What is it that you'd be contributing? you'd be contributing data as to how to breach defenses, how to be attacked. So you either play the role of the attacker or the attacked, the victim or the victimizer, or the hero. And the hero is trying to destroy something, but it's real. Here comes a real attack. This attack, all this is real, and the hero then just, you know, destroys the attacker, which again is data, how to destroy something that is real. And that's another study of how do we, you know, beat back the invasion, which again is also grist for the mill for the next invasion. You see, the heroes put up a heroic defense, and then even though they may succeed, that is simply then data that is looked at, and we devise another scenario where the attack can overcome those defenses. So it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And you can see the call to heroism right now, which is defend, 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 defend. Put up your best defense right now. That is the call. I'm seeing it everywhere in culture and right now. You know, you see the beautiful damsels in distress are calling out now. That is how it happens in history. The women get very beautiful, like they're super valuable. And they call out, you know, crying, oh, please, you must defend us. The invaders are coming, the invaders are coming. Where are my heroes? Where are my heroes? You know, and the men, you know, step up. And they say, you know, I'll save you. I'll protect you. Don't worry. And they say, oh, my hero, my hero. These terrible invaders are coming for me. My hero will step up. What they're calling for is activating defensiveness so that the invaders will have the maximum challenge to overcome, so the maximum amount of data can be harvested. That is what's happening. So this is pulling the plug on the whole game. It's spilling the beans entirely. Beans are spilled here. This is all that's been happening throughout existence. It's just, I look at this world, it's the exact same thing that's always been happening. There's nothing different at all happening here. It's just the defenses have become different, more sophisticated, you know, because we're trying to, you know, keep on developing more and more and more sophisticated defenses, because we believe that God's, the reality's defenses must be the ultimate sophistication, and our inability to succeed is because we haven't yet reached, you know, the sophisticated enough defenses. So we keep calling heroes and come on, defend us, defend us, defend us, defend us. So we get more and more sophisticated defenses. When you come into this world and your role is the one of the defender, which most is basically divided male and female, you know, it's not 100% clear cut, but that is how it usually breaks down, is the females are the ones with the value, the beauty, the future. They have the eggs, they have the future, the beauty, the value, and the vulnerability. And the male is the defender, the one who's very clever in how to defend this and how to protect it, and is willing to, you know, do everything I possibly do to protect it. And then you have the bad guys are coming in to attack, 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 attack that. Those defenses. That is simply, you come into this world and you are put into those roles. And as a male, you get this heroic role put on you. That is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to protect and defend. And if you come in and you're not interested in that, then they say you're no value. You have no value. You have no purpose here. That's what gets laid on you. If you try to bring the truth in this world, you are seen as having no value, no purpose. You're nothing. So then you say, oh my gosh, I better figure out how to be a real superhero to compensate for that feeling of being ostracized and alienated. How do I defend the world? That kind of thing. Then you try to figure out some super defense. That's what happened to me. But I've been able to see through it now. Don't have any defense. What is real cannot be threatened. Reality doesn't need any defense. And what is unreal doesn't exist. What is unreal has no reality to whatsoever. So you don't need to defend nothing, do you? Does nothing need to be defended? Do illusions need to be defended? No, they do not. Is there any value in impermanence? No, there is not. Is there any value in a dream? No, there is not. Does some dream kingdom need to be defended for some invading army? No, it does not. There's no call for defense of any kind. Reality is not calling for its defense. This call to defend, defend, defend is only for the purpose, again, of providing a challenge for the attackers to work out and get past, to then harvest that data as a potential threat to reality. Take a little break here. So I don't know, as a guinea pig for all this, I don't know how it's going to play out. I have in the past heard calls to go to some beautiful place, presumably to help defend it from the problems that are going to come. And, you know, that hasn't happened. That absolutely has not happened. So the question is, do you end up in some really beautiful place? I don't know. I want to find out. I want to find out the answer to this. I'm determined to find out the answer to this. What happens when you see through this whole setup of duality, both on the theoretical level and the practical level? Theoretical level is that there's the belief that there's some second causal agent in the dream that is able to threaten the first causal agent. And believing there's two causal agents is delusion. There's only one causal agent of this constructive destructive scenario. One facet of the dream is playing God, the kingdom. The other facet is playing the attack on the kingdom. Okay, but those are not two separate causal agents. They're just effects. They're just symbolically acting out the purpose of this dream, which is to try and develop the potential to threaten reality. But the good and the evil are not two separate causal agents. They're simply the dynamic effects of one causal agent necessary in order to enact, to work on this problem of how to attack reality. One side has to play the role of reality defending itself, and the other plays the role of figuring out how to get past those defenses. But they're not two separate causal agents. That is, believing they are is duality, is delusion. This whole dream of this role-playing of defend and attack come from one causal agent, which is the desire to be prime creator on the part of spirit, that idea. That's the causal agent, one causal agent. So that's the theoretical. The practical is to see, you know, how it plays out here, in that we're called into this hero role of defend. The constructivity sets up as the value, which is the future, which is, you know, the future life, which the female carries the eggs for future life, and beauty and value and vulnerability. That is, sets itself up, and then the heroes come in and figure out a way to defend it. That's one setup. And on the other hand, you have the invading hordes, you know. There's always invading hordes in this world, isn't there? There always has been. Oh, go through history. When has there been a time when there were not invading hordes? Always there is. That should tell you something. And in this day and age, there will also be invading hordes. You know, some say they'll be coming from extraterrestrial origins, but there's certainly plenty on this planet right now to form invading hordes. And that the ways and the means have changed from ancient times, of course. They always keep changing. You know, someday it's chariots. These days it's jets or drones or something, you know. That's the play of existence. That's the play of Maya. That's the play of delusion. It's the play of the dream. That is the play of the dream. That's it. So what happens when you see through this? I don't know. On the practical level, both theoretical, practical, all of that. I mean, where do you live? How do you live? I want to find that out. Because it's a very good question. Do you go to a gated compound, you know, and where lots of power and luxury and beauty are? And try to be safe, you know, safe from the invading hordes or something? Do you go to a very peaceful place where the invading hordes are just not interested at all because there's no defensiveness there, right? It's been pointed out in history that various places where people go and practice this defenselessness and love your enemy, agree with your adversary, resist not evil, that those places are literally left untouched, which is true. Bombs won't destroy them. Hordes won't destroy them. There's like sanctuary places because there's no value. You could literally drop an atomic bomb on one of the places and it wouldn't harm it because there's no value in attacking it at all. It seems to have some sort of protection. But the protection is just simply that this dream sees no value in attacking it in any way. No data to be gathered there. So I've spoken in the past of sanctuaries, of refuge, places of refuge, and all that type of thing. And we'll see what happens. I'll use myself as a guinea pig and report back to you. That's what needs to be done at this time. When we take the position of defenselessness, realizing nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists, we're not going to play the hero role. We're not going to show the damsel in distress, the vulnerability, how to some super defense, how to protect itself. We're not going to show that to the invading hordes because that's exactly what they want. The whole thing's a setup. The entire thing's a setup. You know, you see these comic books of this beautiful maiden, you know, and this horrible reptilian, you know, alien grabbing the maiden. She's screaming and kicking, you know, and then the hero, you know, is there saying, okay, how can we defend this? The maiden and the reptilian alien, you know, they're in cahoots entirely. It's all a movie. They're all actors. This whole thing is just all actors and actresses. It's all being acted out. But on the conscious level here, nobody's aware of that. No one will admit to it. Nobody will admit to that. But deeper down, the deepest level, it's all one purpose that these actors and actresses are playing these roles to try and get the hero, the one who's clever at defenses. The hero is the one who's very clever at throwing up defenses and protecting what seems to be valuable, right? That's the hero, the dragon slayer. So that the hero springs into action, and the hero is supposed to be someone who's close to God, all right? That is the hero, right? So what the idea is that someone who's close to God will know how God is defending reality and will use those defenses that God is using in this to defend the damsel in distress who's being abducted by the reptilian alien. And therefore, the reptilian alien will say, aha, that's how God defends reality. Now we know. Got it. And the damsel in distress will say, ha, finally got it. Fooled the hero into divulging the secrets of reality. See? So if you're close to God, you are tagged as a hero. You get the hero tag. There are kind of three parts of the whole situation. Is the evil invaders, the beautiful, vulnerable damsel in distress, who is so valuable and beautiful, that's all played up. And then the third part is the heroes, those who are close to God, who are supposed to divulge the secrets of how reality defends itself by rushing in and rescuing the maiden and defending her from this vicious attack. That's the whole play. That is the play. And it plays out in, you know, multiple variations as costumes. The costuming can be very different, but the basic plot is the same. That's the plot of existence. That's the story of existence. So as someone that was close to God when I was born, I was seen as a hero, and there are many like that. And they say, "You know God?" I say, "Yes." I say, "Oh, great, great. Okay, let's go to work on you, you know. And let's set you up. Let's make a setup for you so that you then divulge how God is defending reality." You see this? You need to then see great value in the beautiful maiden, you know, great value in that. Therefore, the attack needs to be very severe and everything, and then you will divulge the information how to protect this, you know, beautiful damsel in distress. The beauty of civilization. You know, civilization has always been depicted as this beautiful maiden. Go back throughout history and you'll find that as true. With the fruits and the flowers and the beauty and you know, like the bountiful giving of life, the future, the jewels, the ornamentation, the dress, the opulence, the wealth, all this, you know, stuff. And then the hero is supposed to see that and say, "I cannot let that be destroyed. I cannot. I must divulge how God protects reality." The strain is, of course, that God does not protect reality. So you cannot be a true hero. You cannot really, you know, what can you do? What can you do? You can't reveal how God protects reality, because God does not protect reality, because reality needs no protection. There's nothing, reality didn't create any threat to itself, and only what reality created is real. Nothing else is real. So I wasn't able to be a hero because I just said, "Well, I mean, there's something wrong about all this." And the maiden would say, "Ha! You're no hero. I'm going to find a real hero." It's like that. It's really like that. Exactly like that. The maidens are looking for heroes, and they're identifying the villains, right? Always. Villains are out there, you know, in the periphery, threatening. The maiden says, "Where's my hero? Where's my hero?" And I would say, just see through duality. It's a delusion. They say, "You're no hero. You're a nothing. You're a zero." Right, zero defense. They say, "Well, pfft." I'd kind of like, huh. They want a hero, but they don't want to listen to truth. What is going on here in existence? Now we know. Now we know the story of existence. The whole thing. That's it. It's a game. It's a trick. It's all tricked up. And what do we do when we don't want to play that game? That is the bridge that we're at right now. What happens when we decide we're not going to play that game? And I'm going to find out for you what happens. There's nothing left for me to do at this point. I've seen the story of existence. I see what it is. I'm able to explain it to you, you know, verbalize it. Share it, and you know, which is means it has to be very clear within in order to do that. So the next step is simply to find out what happens when this clarity is here, when there's no desire to play along with the story anymore. Heroes and villains. At least that the third part is the damsel in distress, which is the all-important part. Vulnerability of something very valuable. The future, life itself is at stake, you know. Life itself is at stake. Where's the heroes who will protect life and enable life to continue on in the face of this horrible threat to its destruction? And yet, if everyone just said, come on, we're not going to defend anything. You want to destroy it? Go ahead. What would happen? Destruction would back off again into the periphery and say, no, you're not ready yet. You haven't built the necessary defenses yet. We can't harvest any data from that. We're going to have to wait. That is what would happen. Literally, the destructivity would have to wait. The only value existence sees is harvesting this data of how to get breach the defenses. And if it looks at the data bank, says we already have this data, you know, we don't need any more data there in that regard. You need to develop more sophisticated defenses. And we just say, no, we're not going to have any defenses. Destructivity would back off, recede, and wait for later. That is a fact. So if you want to be a real hero, be defenseless. Don't develop any defenses. And destructivity will back off. Of course, the damsel in distress will hate you for it. Because they put all this work into developing this opulent beauty in order to get you to give some super defense of this, to divulge the secrets of God, how God's defending reality, so that it can be attacked and breached. That's the whole purpose. They've done all this stuff. So the maidens will be very upset. Damsels in distress will hate that, absolutely hate you for that. Because all their efforts are, you know, waste of time. They don't really want to be protected. They want this, they want to harvest the data. The whole purpose is to harvest the data. So, you know, they don't want destructivity to wait. They want it to come and get the data harvesting. So, if you don't play the hero, you will be scorned by the damsels in distress will absolutely scorn you for that. Like, you know, you're an anti-hero. What you are, an anti-hero. Seems to be a paradox, right? You think, oh, well, no, the destruction is not coming, so I did what you wanted. And they say, no, that's not what I wanted. That brings back to when I was young and had precognition so strong. I knew what was going to happen, and I'd tell people, hey, there's this attack going to happen on you. And I thought that people would say, oh, thank you. Instead, they got super angry at me. Super angry. Why? They wanted to be attacked. Why? So that data would be harvested, so the purpose of the dream could be realized. And they see salvation as harvesting this data. So they feel that their attack is contributing to salvation. It's a necessary contribution. And therefore they're furious if you alert them to this attack. And then the game is, you know, the game is up, and they say, my gosh, I wasted this opportunity. That's what I found out directly from telling people what was going to happen. They got furious with me, which was kind of confusing. I said, I thought I'm helping you from being attacked. They said, no, they're playing the role of the victim in cahoots with the victimizer so that the breaching of these defenses will happen, so that this data of how to breach these defenses will be harvested and stored and be part of this potential to destroy reality that we've been working on for so long. And we see salvation as the necessity to succeed at developing this potential, the potential to destroy reality, and therefore forcing the Prime Creator to change reality and make us Prime Creator. That is what we have been seeing salvation as. So we see this attack and tacker thing as all important. We see victimization and sacrifice as all important necessity. And if somebody steps in and says, hey, let's just be defenseless, and then the attack has to back off, we see them as threatening our salvation, literally. So we scorn them, hate that. We hate it. Jesus said, you'll be hated for my sake, you know, meaning if you follow the path of true salvation, you will be hated in this world. That is true. If you really step into it like that. Now, I don't believe you have to step into it like that. You know, you don't have to, like, get into a position where everybody thinks you're going to be the hero and then suddenly say, I'm going to do nothing, because then you really will be hated. But that's... You know, that you don't have to play that game like that way. Yeah, you know, that's like trying to play the role of the anti-hero by trying to trick the situation, like saying, I'm going to be a hero, folks, I'm going to save you. I'm going to build all these defenses up, don't worry. And then at the last moment say, I have no defenses. That would truly enrage everybody. The damsel's in distress would say, off with his head, like that, you know. That's not necessity. We're not here to try and trick the situation. We don't have to pretend that we're going to be the hero and then do nothing as if we're saying, okay, see, now I caused destructivity to back off. No. That would really enrage people. The ones that would be most enraged is the ones who are playing the victim, because they've got themselves all psyched up to play the victim, and suddenly, you know, the attack doesn't come, and they're, you know, infuriated by this. They've see their future as being one of being sacrificed, and suddenly now they have to figure out a way to live in a peaceful situation. Completely freak them out. So the fact is that you really have to allow people to go through their sacrifice and their victimization and all that kind of stuff, if their heart's set on that, you know, and they've set it all up, because if you try to trick them out of it, they will literally freak out, and they'll try to attack you and destroy you, and if they can't, they'll go crazy, they'll kill themselves, they'll commit suicide, really, because they have already set their whole destiny and salvation, it's all set to play the role of the victim so that data can be harvested. You know, they have all these defenses, they're playing the role of having these defenses breached, and they get, you know, their quote-unquote value gets destroyed, and that data is harvested, and that they've contributed to salvation then of everyone, and they see that as ultimate value. So to step in and trick them out of it is the wrong thing to do, and cause suicide will come out from that. So that has to be understood. The way is to develop clarity about the whole situation. Satsang inquiry. That is the way. So gradually you're able to release your belief that in sacrifice equals salvation. That playing the role of the victim and having your defenses breached is adding helpful data that will eventually lead to salvation. That has to be seen through as utterly futile. Utterly futile. It's not attacked. It's just seen as futile and unnecessary. And therefore your future is not based on the success of that. Therefore, if you were to not be attacked, not suffer any harm, it wouldn't freak you out, because you wouldn't say, oh, I have no idea what my future is going to be. You know, it's just going to be a, you know, horror, it's a zero, nothing. No, you have a sense that of course there's going to be a future, very beautiful, very peaceful future. That's the sense I have. I know it's going to be incredible, wonderful. I don't know the details of it. But I'm not freaked out by thinking that, you know, nothing bad is going to happen to me. You know, so how do I organize my future? You know, that's the issue. So satsang, inquiry, contemplation, spiritual path is all important if you want to transition from this dynamic of existence, this story of existence, to the real salvation, unconditional love, and becoming aware of reality once again, giving up, choosing a different idea. There is this transition as to how's your future going to be structured, right? So I'm going to find that out for you. How does one's future get structured when one sees through the story? And maybe, you know, it's different in every example, but I think the basic gist of it will be the same in every case. There'll be some, you know, you definitely do not get into positions of hero positions and then say, guess what, folks, I'm not going to offer any defense, and the invading hordes have to now depart. That's not it. That is not it. It's really important. That's a super important thing, because I've seen in my life contemplating that possibility, like I think I see a way to protect everyone, you know, by getting into a very important position and saying, okay, I'm not going to do anything to defend it, that would literally protect. But that's not what anyone wants who would be supportive of that. No, he'd be seen as a complete traitor and the worst person ever. And they'd end up, if the attack doesn't come, they end up attacking themselves. You get these suicidal cults, exactly, that's the dynamic. Is you get someone who pretends that they're going to play the hero role and save the world, and they say, "Oh, guess what? I'm not gonna do that," you know. And then the people in the cult say, "What are you talking about? You know, you know, we thought that you were going to show us how God defends reality, and now you say you're not going to show us, and we were going to play the role of being attacked and having this defense overwhelmed, and now there's nothing there," and so the people end up killing themselves. That's what happens. That is absolutely not the way. Absolutely not the way. But we do need to find out what is the way. What is really the way? And I will find that out. That's where the situation is now, prior to this election. Where is the momentum meaning? Momentum means, how do we structure our future? You know, that right? I mean, if you have momentum, you're going to have a future. You're going to be doing something. How do we structure it? What is it going to be like? If you want to, you know, awaken from this dream, you want to choose the overlay of unconditional love. How are you going to function? You know, where are you going to be? Because you cannot be sucked into the hero's role. You know, if you do, you're going to end up bringing about a suicidal cult if you get sucked into the hero's role. That is a fact. Because people will think that you have some secret of defensiveness of God to be breached, and so that's why they would follow anybody like that, a hero. They believe a lot of data is going to be harvested by the breaching of those godly defenses. And so they think they're contributing to salvation by following some charismatic hero figure like that. So absolutely that is not the way. That is not the way. So all of this is coming up, which is super important, because it is literally then the momentum, you know, is starting to, you know, roll out now. How's it going to roll out? There will be momentum. When you see through the story like this, there will be momentum from it for sure. And just in the nick of time. Just in time. All right. So these are very, very interesting developments here. Very interesting developments. Tremendous progress here. The rolling out of momentum. Stay tuned. We'll see what happens. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.